Hachette Audio presents The Woman in the Dark, written by Vanessa Savage, read by Siriol Jenkins.
Headline from the Western Mail, May 2017. Two more bodies found in the murder house. It's been so long since you lived here, and everything and nothing in this town has changed. The graffiti is dirtier, darker, the rot more deep-seated. A smell that lingers. A pus-stained bandage, a red streak of infection meandering away from the rotting heart of it. This house has always been the entry wound, sealing the infection in so it spreads under the surface, hidden, insidious, swelling and killing the healthy flesh around it. And you... you at the centre. The dirty needle, the rusty knife, the cause and the result. In my dream, the one I told you about, the dream I have where the house is still just a house and not yet the murder house. All the rooms on the landing have doors and all the doors are closed. They're always closed. But last night, the dream changed. This time the corridor was longer, and there was a new door at the end. And instead of running, as I always do, from the dragon in the man suit, half falling in that world-tipping way of dreams and thinking I'll never get to the end, this time I knew I would make it. But I don't want to anymore. There's a door at the end that shouldn't be there. There's another door, and this one is open. Part 1. Before. Chapter 1. Sarah. January 2017.
Happy anniversary, Sarah.
When I open my eyes, Patrick is next to the bed holding a gift-wrapped box. He's already dressed and I glance at the clock. 8 a.m. Oh, God. The kids. Patrick's breakfast. I should have been up an hour ago.
Relax, he says, sitting down.
He pushes my hair out of my face and bends to kiss my forehead, smiling into my eyes as he does so.
Mia and Joe have already left for school. You stay in bed.
He holds out the box and I sit up, pulling the quilt to cover me. I look at the gift. The paper is silver and shiny, creases sharp and perfect on the edges, curling silver ribbon tied on the top. In an elaborate bow. But it's not...
Not a real anniversary, no.
This one is more important. He lifts my hand and kisses it. He turns it over, kisses my palm, then up to my wrist. My mind is scrabbling for the date, but then I remember and relax. 21st of January, the date we first met.
Open it,
he says, pushing the box into my hand. My fingers fumble over the ribbons and he laughs and helps me, tearing off the paper and lifting the lid of the box. It's a CD. I lift it out, frowning, then see what it is. And the frown fades. That old Verve album I loved so much. On the track listing, Bittersweet Symphony is right there at the top.
Do you remember?
Of course I do. I close my eyes, and I'm back at that student party. A dark, smoke-filled room, carpet sticky with cheap booze, all of us drunk, a tangle of teenagers sprawled on the floor passing bottles. Then, Bittersweet Symphony comes on, and this man, this ridiculously out-of-place man in a suit, comes over and asks me to dance. All that noise and all those people. No one else dancing. And he twirls me round like we're in some grand ballroom.
I thought we could dance to it tonight, he says. You can dust off your Doc Martens and I'll soak the carpet with cheap rum.
He kisses me again, and this time he lingers. I can smell his aftershave, the spicy, heady scent he's always worn. I can taste coffee on his lips, feel the rough brush of his cheek against mine. I'm half asleep and groggy, and I can't remember how long it's been. Weeks, months even. How long since we had sleepy morning sex, slow and languid, quiet because of the children. I reach up to pull him closer, but he moves away, letting the cold in. Stay, I whisper. I have to go to work. Tonight, though, we'll go to dinner tonight, somewhere special. Just the two of us, he says. Back to Patrick, all grown up, buttoned behind a suit. Not the Patrick who lay on that booze-soaked carpet, laughing as I danced around him. But it's all still there, isn't it? That Patrick, that Sarah. In the curve of his smile, his soft laugh, the way he looks at me as the quilt slips down. All still there, just muffled by the day-to-day. Stay, I say again, pulling him closer and sliding his jacket off his shoulders. He laughs and begins nuzzling my neck.
You're terrible, Mrs. Walker.
When he leaves the bedroom, I fall back onto the pillows, closing my eyes, a smile on my face. I could sleep, sneak another hour before facing the day. But Patrick's calling me from downstairs. I get up and reach for the threadbare dressing gown hanging on the back of the door. Patrick always teases me about this ratty old thing. He bought me a new, thick, luxurious one I never wear because my mother gave me this a million years ago when I left home. I've worn it ever since, and I'll wear it until it falls apart because I have so little left to remind me of her. Patrick is in the hall, holding up an envelope. When did this come? I feel a flash of guilt. I remember the letter. It arrived the other day, handwritten, addressed to Patrick. I picked it up off the mat, but instead of giving it to him, I stuffed it into the drawer because it's handwritten, because the handwriting is feminine. Sorry, I say. I must have put it in the drawer instead of on the top. I watch him stare down at the letter. I'm ready to apologise again as I go down the stairs, but when I see Patrick's face, I stop. I recognise angry. He's not angry. I don't know what this is. What? I ask. And when he looks at me, his eyes are burning and full, like he might cry. There are spots of red on his cheeks. He glances at the letter once more, then pushes it into his coat pocket.
There's nothing. Nothing important.
It is, though. I've never seen Patrick look like that before. Fear, chasing elation, chasing something. Or have I? I have, I think, once. Caroline's text comes through half an hour after Patrick leaves, and she's knocking at the door 10 minutes later, two steaming paper cups in her hands and a stack of travel brochures under her arm. Cappuccino delivery? She says. You look disgustingly awake, I say, opening the door wider and pushing my hand through my tangled hair. It's only 9:30, but Caroline looks like she's been up for hours, fully made up, hair sleek and shiny. It's a gorgeous day out there, cold but gorgeous, she says, as she follows me through to the kitchen. We're going for a walk, after I fortified myself with sugar and caffeine. I put down the coffee cup and flip through the brochures. Thanks for these. I'd never even considered the Cayman Islands, I say, pausing on a page of turquoise sea and white sand. Have you chosen where you're going yet? Caroline asks, and I sigh. You don't have to keep doing this, you know. Doing what? Bringing you coffee? All of it. Turning up every morning, this false bright Caroline. Up until a few months ago, I don't think you opened your eyes before midday. But now, you and Patrick, it's like a relay. He goes, you arrive. Her smile fades. Yeah, well, up until a few months ago, I never had to worry about you being alone in the house, did I? You don't have to worry now. Don't I?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.